here. The subject is given to me. The any higher education institute, any university or any research laboratory, if you read the vision statement, the summary of all the vision statements is generation of new knowledge and its dissemination for the well-being of the society. So I'm giving vision statements of, just as an example, of three institutions in the world, and you will find that this is the sign. Next slide. Say ICT Mumbai, my institution, and come to the last sentence. We will have the greatest impact on the society and benefit mankind at large. That is the last statement. If you see CSR NCL Pune, to provide scientific industrial research and development that maximizes the economic, environmental and social benefit for the people of India. If you take MIT USA, then also at the end it says the MIT community, the ability and passion to work wisely, creatively, effectively for the betterment of humankind. So, higher education creates new knowledge, disseminates it for the well-being of the society. And if I want to pick the biggest problem that our country faces, is our country is poor. So, if the first and foremost objective has to be of higher education is to eradicate the poverty. So I'm going to tell you the relationship between the science, technology, innovation, and per capita income or poverty of a nation. Here I have picked up some nations of the world. And the y-axis is per capita, the innovation ranking. And x-axis is per capita income. Without going into the details, you can see the place for India in terms of per capita income. It stands 140 number in total number of 152 nations. It is 12th from the bottom. So we should understand quantitatively how much we are poor. And if you see the parity plot, the per capita income is directly proportional to innovation index. Our innovation index is also very poor, close to 82. So if at all higher education has to address the foremost problem of the nation, then the development of innovativeness to solve this particular problem. It is well known, and large number of surveys have shown that any innovation of a nation, if you count all the innovations, more than 50% innovations, they happen in the university. So therefore, it is a natural duty of higher education to innovate, and innovate in such a way that it solves the problems of society, and in this particular case, the poverty of our country. Next slide. Why our country is poor? I'm going to explain in using three slides. The major income of any nation comes from three sources: the industrial activity, the agricultural activity, and the service sector, overall service sector. About 65% to 70% of the income comes from these three sources. Now, this slide shows the income coming from industry. Now, since I'm close to chemical technology, here the sectors, the industries considered are in chemical technology. So in chemical industry, the overall worldwide turnover is 14 million crores, whereas India's participation in world market is 2 lakh crores. our Indian industry is doing business worldwide, which is 1.4%. If you take herbal healthcare, which is the science which we are strongly proud of, originated from our country, 1.5 million crores is the worldwide turnover, and we participate 15,000 crores, and it is 1%. Food processing, electronics is 0.1, mechanical, aerospace is close to zero. So if industry sector is participating 1 plus minus 0.5%, that will be the income of the country. If you see the agricultural sector, the next slide, here large number of products have been listed: rice, wheat, mangoes, potatoes, soybean, onion, etc. And the per hectare production is given in the next column. And if you see any row, if you see tomato number 9, per hectare we produce 19.3, whereas what is proven is 524 tons. So it is 50 times, almost 25 times larger. Soybean is 3 times less. So more or less in all the cases. So after green revolution also, our productivity of agriculture is pretty low. And if you take service sector, the next slide. In industry, normally the turnover of any company is 20 times the salary of a person. So suppose I'm getting 10 lakh rupees, then I'm participating in the turnover of the company, which is 2 crores. The service industry in India, the turnover is typically 3 times the salary. What it means, the quality of our service sector is also not bringing wealth to the country. So all these three sectors put together, contributing 65 to 70%, the total income of the country is 130 lakh crores. We together have 130 crores, and a simple arithmetic says that the per capita income is 1 lakh per person, and therefore we are poor. So we need to see what is that we can do, enhance the income in all these three sectors as well as many other sectors. And the principal driver, which I have told you and I emphasize again, is innovation. If we improve the innovation ranking, and that happens only through higher education, then we are likely to get prosperous. Next slide. Whatever income we have, how do we spend? Lot of money goes in crude oil buying, which is 12 lakh crores. Out of 130 lakh crores, 10% goes there. This slide has been provided to me by Dr. Kakodkar. Electronic equipment, machines, huge amount of money we spend, the poor country spends, in buying things, importing things from outside. We have almost become buyers. There are very few things which we can feel proud of and say that whatever you see here, the projector and then the laser pointer and the polyester and the cars through which we have come and the aeroplane, you name anything, no innovation has come from India. So the relationship between innovation and poverty is really abundant. And I'm going to repeat this again and again in order to bring out the message that where the higher education should go. Next slide. I think this slide is really will speak for our nation. The titanium, total reserves of titanium ores in the world, 600 million tons. Reserves in India, 100 million tons. And we are considered second in the world. Now we have the ores required for titanium. What do we do? Right? I'm explaining again and again why we are poor. We sell the ore at the rate of 6 rupees a kilogram, and whatever titanium is required for our purpose, we buy from outside at 2,500 rupees per kilogram. Right? Next slide. So that was, using these slides, I have emphasized why we are poor, and what is the principal objective of higher education, that is innovation for the cause of the nation. Now I'm picking up some opportunities of transformative potential which is available with the universities. Obviously, with the time limit, I will give some examples. The first one I have picked up is the opportunities of transformative potential in agriculture, post-harvesting, and bioenergy, all this put together. Next slide. This slide I have already shown, and Marathi Vidyan Parishad, the organization to which I belong, we took soybean productivity enhancement as an example. Why soybean? Because we import the oil seeds worth 80,000 crores and we also buy palm oil from outside. And if productivity of soybean is increased by 50% in the land which is allocated to soybean at right now, then the problem gets solved. Therefore, the soybean as a product was. So right now it is 1.1 tons and the what is proven is 3.7 tons. We want just 50%. And in agricultural productivity, there are many, many points which decide the productivity, right from the seed, the soil, the water management, the use of fertilizers, agrochemicals, and many. So if I want to make any substantial difference, then I need to take help of expertise in all these cases. So innovation will happen only when I consult, put all that knowledge together, and then with the help of our young students, by the way, my experience of 40 years of research is, our young students are very, very capable. So they have been able to not only see the maximum productivity of the overall world, they have already gone ahead of that. So it is possible. So in the research part of it, then it will consist of many, many things, not only chemical engineering or chemistry, the soil analysis, but many, many things, the microbiology, seed-related aspects. Next slide. Now, suppose I'm successful and I'm capable of making, increasing the productivity 3 times. Right now, whatever we produce is sufficient for the nation. And if I produce 3 times, then what will happen? The prices will crash, and finally, farmer will not get anything from enhancing the productivity. So the opportunity I'm saying here is, when we enhance the productivity, can we solve the problem of energy of the nation? And if we do post-harvesting properly, how much is the worldwide market for post-harvested product? And because of implementing all these opportunities, how much wealth can be generated? And how many jobs can be generated? And how it should be made possible through innovations in higher education? What I am saying is, energy need of the country just now is 900 million metric tons equivalent right now, that is total. Later on I am going to show that from biomass like bamboo, we need about 1200 million metric tons of bamboo in order to get 900 million metric tons equivalent. The efficiency of photosynthesis normally is 0.3%. Our bamboo is grown or any other mass on dry biomass basis, we grow 10 tons per hectare per year. That is 0.3% efficiency. Now, how many innovations and how many scientists need to come together for enhancing this? 0.3% to 0.6%, 0.9%, 1%. So it is possible to go up to 4.5%, and I have personally involved so that the efficiency is now 3%. But if, and I'm sure, I'm seeing the success that it can go to 4.5%. So if 4.5% is the photosynthesis efficiency, the land required for growing the biomass, which will suffice for the energy requirement of the nation, is 8 million hectares. Please note that no single energy source solves the problem. Always there has to be energy mix. The point I'm emphasizing again and again, that higher education should innovate, and innovate in such a way that it should solve the problems of the nation. So see here, in all these examples, the perspective of the lecture. So the considering the present requirement of the energy, 2.4% of the land is required. And if we want to enhance the per capita income four times, and suppose say five times energy is required, the land required is only 12%. But if we use the current growth rate, then 45% land is required, and five times, of course, there is no land, and there is always a problem of food versus energy. So the food versus energy problem can be solved. So the point I'm arriving at here is, using the same land, can we make the income of the country two times? One is through energy, food, and food processing. How much is the energy requirement of the nation? It is in the range of 20 to 25 lakh crores of that order. Next slide. So I have taken the example of bamboo. It really doesn't matter which biomass, but that biomass, waste biomass, if you take 5 kilograms and do biomethanation, I have simplified the entire processes. And then after separation, we get biomethane. Now a work of 12 years and biologists, engineers, mechanical, chemical, all put together, now we can claim that we have a technology which is cheapest in the world. That is, cheapest in the world. Now we are able to produce methane, that is natural gas. Now it is not natural gas, it is biogas, at the rate of 25 rupees. And we are buying LNG from outside in the range of 35 to 40 rupees. So 5 kilograms of biomass having calorific value of 20,000 kilocalories together finally gives 12,000 kilocalories. That is, overall energy efficiency of the process is 75%. And therefore, from the overall energy requirement, I calculated the quantity of biomass. So here, if we give 3 rupees per kilogram to the farmer and growth rate is 150 tons per hectare, the income is 4.5 lakh rupees per hectare. There is no crop existing right now in our country which can give 4.5 lakh rupees per hectare per year. So this innovation on one side solves the problem of energy. By the way, growing of bamboo, making of methane, making hydrogen from methane, the fuel cell and a car, this is going to appear at one location in near future in India. So I'm telling you the example of only methane part of that overall cycle. And now the technology can be implemented, that is maybe 10 villages together, 20 villages together, and the methane can be made. And it is the cheapest. Right now, the CNG is sold at 45 rupees a kilogram. Cost of production is 25. Farmer gets 4.5 lakh rupees per hectare. And such an innovation can make the country rich. Another methodology of biotechnology, there are various ways. We take waste biomass, and there are biotechnological processes, and we get either ethanol or butanol or monomers of variety of polymers. And here also in our institution, the 313 liters of alcohol has been made from 1 ton of biomass, which is the highest in the world, or at par, let me say at the par. But the beautiful part is the cost of production, overall cost of production, that is the least. Next slide. This is that bio-CNG. You can see that there is a biogas tank on the backside, and there is a station. This is actually existing. And the gas is being sold at 45 rupees. Next slide. The another way to treat biomass is pyrolysis, that is heating in absence of air, and we get gases, liquids, and char. Gases have calorific value, and that can sustain the endothermic reaction of pyrolysis. Liquids can be processed further, having a property similar to crude oil. So what I'm saying is there can be an energy mix. We need also liquid products. And the char, it has the fertilizer value. Char has a property of porosity, the water retaining capacity, the ion exchange capacity. So when we say a fertile land and unfertile land, it can be expressed quantitatively. That is, when we analyze the soil in terms of physical properties like permeability, the chemical analysis and microbiological analysis, the difference between the fertile land and unfertile land, that can be expressed. And whatever is the difference, it can be injected on the char, and char is spread. By the way, now this research is picking up throughout the world, and the carbon in biochar is an available, bioavailable carbon, and that becomes very useful. The most recent MIT report, they have also become very active in pyrolysis. Next slide. So how many additional opportunities are there? The worldwide market for post-harvest food processing products is 36 million crores of rupees. And this is 3 times more than our total income of the nation, 3 times more. And we should really aspire for at least 10%. Why 1%? I'm going to give you one or two examples just as a taste, for the taste, that we can even capture 60%, 70% market of the nation. The chemical industry, including petroleum, it is 80 million crores. And IT plus service industry is 50 million crores. But what is required? If you want to be competitive in the nation, then where innovations are required? What is that higher education should do? That the fundamental first principle approach, that is the basic science, the fundamental science, from that the contribution should be in such a way, plus engineering science of course, all the equipment which are being used in chemical industry and food processing industry, they need to be miniaturized. And the capital cost, I'm saying by a factor of 3, because about which I'm confident. And the operating cost should be reduced by 50%. If that happens, then only we will be world competitive. Otherwise, there is no chance. Of course, we have to keep quality as well. Maintain quality, enhance safety, and make processes green. Now, having done these innovations, normally academic people, they complain that whatever we innovate, industry doesn't pick up. Our industry says normally that academic institutions are not useful to us. And this keeps on going. So the real solution to the problem we should find out, the trust for each other, the faith in each other, it doesn't happen overnight. We have to cultivate it over a long time. And the methodology that we adopt is when a young faculty member is employed, he spends the entire summer vacation either in industry or society, wherever the faculty member likes, right? And then the abundant problems are already there in industry and society. Whenever we solve any problem in industry and as a young faculty member and tell the solutions, the industry is unwilling to implement. There, it is important to keep perseverance and patience and keep on suggesting the answers. One day it will come that some requirement is there in terms of either quality or productivity, and one of those suggestions come in the mind of some manager and that is implemented. And whatever is implemented, the income is far more than what any faculty member or any institution can demand or can have any desire. So when that is implemented, then relation starts. And that relation has to be built up slowly. Then second problem, what is very important, there are many, many cases in our world. Innovations have happened in our institution, educational institutions. In some cases, they have been implemented also. People have invested in a big way. And the industry was profitable for some time. And because of some reason, the outside product comes at a cheaper rate, and then the industry collapses. Now, whenever this possibility is there, the innovation should consist of a margin for this. If anybody in the world can make it at such a price, why we cannot make it at that price? So the support of educational institution to industry, it should be total, not only at the beginning. Whenever problem is there, the problem should be solved completely, and then the prices can be brought down. Next slide. So this developing trust is very, very important. Once trust is developed, then you can demand money in advance before solving any problem. I can give you some live examples. I built a hostel in my, and I wanted furniture. And I'll not tell the detailed story what was their problem. Told them that for 400 students, for each one I want a cot, A cupboard, a table and chair multiplied by 4, and it was there within 2 months. And then their problem was solved later on using chromatographic separation. So this trust should not be personal, it has to be institutional. This is yet another opportunity, and we are working under the guidance of Dr. Kakolkar. It is beam down approach and in the area of solar energy. Of course, solar energy is known, solar thermal is known. What is very important is if we generate steam out of solar energy, then the steam price should be equivalent to the steam generated by the coal. And if we put that as a requirement, then innovations are important. Then all basic sciences, physics people have to come together, material scientists, the mechanical engineers, the chemical engineers, and there are so many components here that they need to come together. So this can happen only when the cost of the reflector and all the costs put together as expressed in the cost of reflector is of the order of 5,000 rupees, which is currently more than 18,000 rupees. So now the innovations are very, very important. At the present stage, we have come down to about 7,000 rupees. But when we come to 7,000 rupees, then further opportunities, those are seen. Next slide. This is for the academician's purpose, because the recognition and the promotions of academic people, as far as current culture is concerned, it depends upon the number of publications and quality of publication. Now here the nature climate change, it has the impact factor is very high, more than 16, 17. So whenever we solve real problem using fundamental sciences, publishing a paper is no problem. And whenever it has utility, then the number of citations are high and the recognition is also high. Now this particular point, it must be assimilated by educational institutions, that by innovating, we are satisfying the one requirement of publishing papers, but we are also solving the real problems of the society. Next slide. This particular slide I show, in any lecture I am invited, no matter which lecture. I definitely show this slide. I have about 5 minutes.
About 3 minutes, sir.
Okay. Let me see. Yeah, okay. In 80s, there is a requirement of hydrogenation in making, say, the paracetamol or converting the vegetable oil into ghee. Hydrogenation is required. So in 80s, how hydrogenation was done? Take iron filings and put acid on that. And all of us have learned Fe plus HCl gives FeCl2 plus hydrogen. And whatever is to be hydrogenated is put directly into the system of iron filings and acid. Of course, hydrogenation was happening, but there were two problems. Per kilogram of product, there was 5 kilogram of waste biomass. And another problem was the waste mass, the waste mass of iron, and it was trapping some of the product. So yield was very poor, right? And the yield is one problem, but what is hydrogenated, that is carcinogenic. So taking care of this waste is also a problem. But doing hydrogenation by catalytic hydrogenation, this was known in the world. But it was not known in India. So a friend of mine from industry, he requested me to go to Switzerland to the equipment manufacturer for catalytic hydrogenation and let us see the buy and solve the pollution problem at least. I went there, and for 2 ton capacity of hydrogenation, the quotation was 10 crores of rupees. Why our nation is poor is because of this reason. If you buy anything at such a price, and if you take loan of 10 crores and have depreciation and interest, our paracetamol cannot be sold worldwide. It cannot become cheaper than the world. The material required for making such reactor is not more than 10 or 12 lakhs rupees. And we were asked to give 10 crores of rupees. I came back, obviously. But the industrialist was very wise. He said that we have excellent the fabrication facility in our country. Let us ask the Swiss people to just give the drawings and we will make it here. I went back and the Swiss people were very, very happy to give the drawings. The only thing they said, the cost of drawings is 9.7 crores. And you say whatever you want. What it means is, we were not innovative, they were innovative, and they were asking the price of their innovation, right? And that was the beginning. Within 2 years, the same reactor was made in 30 lakh rupees, including price, everything, including everything. Of course, when it can be made in 30 lakh rupees, I'm telling selling price, not the making price. So if it is possible, then 100 technologies were developed and no equipment. Swiss people reduced the price from 10 crores to 5 crores to 2 crores. Right? But nobody can buy. Nobody will buy. So in a similar manner, several such equipment have been built up by innovating means to understand what is the basic phenomena which is controlling catalytic hydrogenation and whether every point in the reactor, whether it can be made efficient so that the overall cost can be brought down. The point I am saying is the business people, they don't honor any nationality. They honor only money. So if you can make it in 30 lakh rupees here, the Swiss people and German people, they started buying from India because it is available now in 50 lakh rupees, 60 lakh rupees. It depends upon whatever prices. And in this manner now, variety of equipment have been designed and they are being exported. One German company has been closed down because of this. That is not the desire. The main point is, whatever are the requirements of the nation, the innovation should happen in the university in such a way they are sustainable. And the basic innovation is based on the excellence of basic sciences. Next slide. So this is the last slide. The vision statement is already there, but I think at least once in a month, we should request the faculty to read the vision statement of vision statement of the institute needs to be followed in letter and spirit. Orientation of scientists to undertake relevant, the overall culture of our institutions, this is the word used by Dr. Kakadkar. The culture is in such a way, why this culture has been made? Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize, all the fellowships of the academies. The requirement of these fellowships and requirement of all these prizes are in such a way that national priorities are forgotten. And entire peer recognition system, it orients all the people away from national priorities. So whether we can have a parallel recognition structure, perhaps more prestigious than this, so that the national priorities can be brought into higher education. The orientation of scientists to undertake relevant research with sustainable excellence, having global standards. Anyway, if you want to make any product which is competitive in the world, which is cheap and which needs less operating costs, then the quality of science required is also high. Outcome will be implemented technology as well as quality improvement in higher education. Systems and methods for the implementation of technologies in industry and society. Now, for this particular part, I'm going to show the next slide, the silage concept floated by Dr. Kakodkar, which I will show as the next slide. To develop mutual faith and trust, according to me, this particular statement is most important. Without money, people can believe, they can believe you. But there has to be trust, mutual trust in overall approach, there's respect for each other. Otherwise, industry people are very good in arranging conferences, giving food, many lunches and dinners, but nothing more than that. Right? So if anything you say is to be implemented, but once trust is there, then they implement everything, whatever you say. Then you need to be careful, whatever you are saying for implementing. And lastly, improving the scientific temper of the society. We cannot have excellence and innovations in higher education unless there is overall scientific temper. In school education, are we doing experiments? I read the syllabi of all the countries in the world, and if you do 150 experiments from 6 to 10 standard, then you can pass any examination of any nation. But in majority of schools, I will not be surprised, more than 90-95% of the schools, experiments are not done. These are just demonstrated in some cases. These are not even demonstrated. And scientific temper has many aspects. The science in everyday life, in kitchen, in education, which I mentioned, and this is the job that I am doing just now through Marathi Vidyan Parishad. The systems and methods which I mentioned to you, and that is my last slide, the next slide, the silage concept, that there has to be a connectivity between a knowledge generator and knowledge providers. I don't have time to explain this, But this is a very beautiful concept, and I'm working, I'm cooperating, helping, trying to take it further so that our nation becomes rich one day. Thank you so much.